from Nordea was giving a speech in Denmark. No? Bear with us. 2 seconds.
Lessons we learned then, which we see been working with sensors for many, many years, decades. Aerospace has been using them for 30, 40, 50, 60 years. Many other organizations have been using them even longer. And we were collecting data from them. We were monitoring the data. In the 80s, aerospace went for on-condition monitoring, engine condition monitoring. And we learned a lot of interesting things about our sensors then. But now we wrap it up in the title, IoT, the new magic. Connected, internet connected, the cloud, and so on. And curiously, we seem to have forgotten almost all of the lessons we learned over the last 50 years about sensors and accuracy in monitoring the information coming from them and using that information for value. It's the new magic. And we need to remember there are lots of really important questions. If we're going to get value for our company, our suppliers, our customers, our users. Questions. We all need to be highly skeptical about every new hyped technology. Not cynical. Cynical just says, I don't believe you. Skepticism says, that sounds interesting, prove it. Here are the questions you need to answer if you're going to prove it to me. So I try to teach my students to be skeptical, to not believe everything the marketeers say. You know, we have a saying in England, I guess it's probably universal, would you trust a car salesman? We've seen one or two rather interesting examples of that over the last 10, 15 years. The last time I was at a management events conference was November 14th, 15th, last year. And that was a very interesting week. It was a week, finished on the 14th, and in the 7 days leading up to that, five or six leading tech companies basically announced that they were changing everything. It started with John Krafcik from Waymo, Google Cars. He suddenly announced on TV, you know all that AV stuff we're talking about, the cars will be driving themselves everywhere within, well, by about 2025. He says, actually, we now realize that level 4, level 5 autonomous vehicles will not be available, capable of driving in all conditions everywhere for many decades yet. So suddenly, the day before, the corporate position was AVs, L4, L5, kind of about 2025, 27-ish, 14th of November. It ain't going to happen. We don't know how to make it happen. Uber and Lyft, about 3 days earlier, had announced that they were busy buying up electric scooter companies, they were busy buying up electric bicycle companies, they were busy coming to arrangements, particularly Uber, with rapid transit systems in to become mobility as a service, not autonomous vehicle taxi companies, which they've been selling for a long time. That same week, Amazon said, AI, it's not what it's all made out to be. We burnt our fingers. We tried to produce an HR advisory system to filter job applications. And a year before, January 2018, they finally killed off the project because they couldn't get it to be non-sexist. It would only process and accept male applicants for those jobs. It turned out that because of trainees on data, the last 10,000 job applications, which all were, the ones which were accepted, were all male. So the learning system naturally learns. Amazon doesn't employ women. And of course, as a learning system, without changing the data, it won't learn anything differently. And the biggest one was interesting. Again, in that 4-7 day period, IBM reversed direction on Watson Cognitive. Watson was their big flagship from 2012 for about 7 years, 6 years. Watson Cognitive was the way that the company was going to go. And suddenly, they paid $40 billion to buy a Red Hat Linux, changing completely the corporate direction away from AI, cognitive systems, to computing infrastructure. So we have at the background these questions. These are all about hype, advanced emerging technologies that people haven't really been asking the right questions about. And there were amazing things went wrong. And then the IPOs of Uber and Lyft last couple of months. Again, enormously hyped. High prices, high valuations. And after the IPOs, the shares dropped 10, 15, 20%. Because people weren't asking the right questions. So I want to give you a few questions in the time I've got available about what should we be doing with our IT, with the IoT. Now, it is interesting, and I don't know how many of you have seen the Standish Group chaos report numbers. Has anybody seen them before? They've been publishing the data about successful, challenged, and failed projects that are related to IT since 1994. And they survey lots of CIOs every year about how things are going. And up until around about 2012-13, the definition of a successful project was on time, to budget, delivering the contracted for functionality. Failed projects are obviously the ones that never get into service, and the challenged ones in the middle are typically challenged projects coming up about 40% late, 40% over budget, and delivering about 40% of the functionality. Now, CIOs got really touchy, and for some good reason. They said, look, most of our delivery cycles of big projects these days tend to be quite long, and the world is changing all the time, so we can't expect to have to deliver what we signed up for 5 years ago. We can really do with, does it actually deliver value to the business? So eventually in 2013, Standish Group said, we agree with you. We will pick up on that definition, on time, to budget, delivering business value. And of course, all these CIOs thought that would increase the success rate. As you can see, with that line, which is the new definition, which they back calibrated the previous 2 years, kind of interesting. Adding or replacing functionality with delivering business value seemed to reduce the success rate. This actually is quite a problem for the industry and for shareholders, that overall we're running at an astoundingly low level of success with our IT-related projects. And that turns out to affect all types of IT-related projects, whether it's AI, traditional, blockchain, all of these things. We are not very good because we're not asking the right questions most of the time. It costs the world an awful lot of wasted resources. I'd like to go on more about it, but we haven't got time. The point is we need to think about how do we deliver value with our IT projects. We also have to recognize that we don't or we can't trust most of the data we have around us. I'm not saying it's wrong for certain, But we don't know which data are right or which data are wrong, and by how much they are wrong. John Easton was saying back in 2012 from IBM, is 80% of all the data around us is of uncertain veracity. And when we start looking at sensor data, and particularly consumer sensor data, we can get very, very wrong indeed. Here are basically the five fundamental questions that you have to ask yourself about all of your sensors, whether industrial quality or even consumer. The calibration of the equipment. You know, if you think about your weighing machine in the bathroom, when you switch it on, it goes through a little self-checking process to make sure it's reading zero. Because if you stand on it, or press on it, or something, it'll do stuff, and you won't get an accurate reading. So you have to think about zero points, you have to think about the range of sensitivity and consistency, and that's one of the biggest problems very often. And also, how does that calibration drift over time? If you leave it on for days, weeks, months, how on earth do you know whether it's still reading a right number of parts per million, or the right number of whatever it's supposed to be, because it's not being recalibrated. The other area we need to think about very carefully too is about detecting the anomalies, because all sensors read randomly on occasion for a variety of reasons. They just spike. There's all sorts of stuff that makes them deliver a wrong reading. And also about, in terms of the algorithms, can we detect these anomalies, and how are our calculations are taking the readings to the output that we're wanting to get, are we sure that those are actually producing both sensible and valuable answers? Lots of approaches, lots of devices, and on a consumer level, they are potentially very, very sensitive devices or sensors, but they can be inaccurate. And the question you have to be asking yourself is it at the sensor level or the processing algorithm level that's causing us problems? We use GPS on our mobile phones, our smart devices, all the time to say where we are. I've got a tracker. It's actually, if we look at that one, it's this camera tracker. It tags the photos, and you switch it into one mode, and it just continuously tracks where you've been. Stick it outside for 24 hours or thereabouts, and you can see I'm moving. It's moving, or it's reading. It's kind of processing the data. And Alistair Worth is talking in a couple of sessions' time. Has done quite a bit of work with this, knows quite a lot about it. And he understands, or used to understand, I think he said, quite why it is that the technology delivers these sort of things. But from many perspectives, I don't care what the technology is doing underneath it. It's what comes out at my level, where I can see where I'm trying to do stuff, or where your customers are trying to do stuff. And so we can see the dance. Something like 40, 50 feet in either direction, in all directions around the base area. That's kind of okay. I don't mind that too much. It's not going to affect you guys. Starbucks used that location to say, here's a token for your nearby Starbucks. I don't really care if I'm at the top end up there or down here. It's still quite close enough. But it's not just at that level. I was in Dallas at a conference with SAS a month ago. I was there, walked along that path and there, and for some reason, the tracker moved me from there to there and then took me on that route around there. I was walking across there and down there. And yet, it puts me in all sorts of. It just actually use that signal to drive a car. That gets more interesting. However, this is the one that I've never seen before with that tracker. And this was quite surprising. And I've had to look inside the data. I can't see why it's wrong. However, I was in Dallas, basically around there. And then it took me on a journey down to Houston, 300 miles away. And I'm not quite certain yet, I've not had enough time enough to look at all the data, but there's about 2 hours worth journey where it had gone haywire. Now that's interesting, because if that record was in my phone and the police were doing some forensics on where was I, here is evidence I was down in Houston at those hours. Unfortunately, I didn't actually check out while doing that where my phone thought I was. Now, the thing that's interesting about GPS, compared with most of the sensors that industrial sensors are using, GPS produces a number which has 9 significant digits. Plus or minus 180, 0.6 digits. Now, 6 digits is equivalent, but the 6th digit of accuracy is that much. The GPS can locate you to within, it says, 4 inches. Now, most of the sensors we get normally produce, 2, 3, 4 significant digits. So that's kind of different. So we're looking at a percentage error in that last digit of about 6.6%. That's much better than almost any device we're interested in. So GPS tells us something interesting about extreme precision. But the problem with that extreme precision is that the human experience on the surface of the Earth is in feet, meters, kilometers. And kilometers is round about the, where is it? Distance. You're about the second, the fifth significant digit. If you process the data, you can find anomalies by looking at acceleration. That is the physical maximum acceleration a car, an ordinary car, can manage, half a G, 5 meters per second squared. Look at the number of anomalies. Those show points which are significantly out of place. Tracking data, activity tracking, health. Companies, health insurance companies, are using these very limited accuracy. Take two of these devices, they will count steps plus or minus 30% difference. They allege to calorie count. It is unethical, I say, to use these sort of things to base your premium on, insurance premium, and then charge your clients a £12 a week penalty for not achieving their steps, because these are known to be inaccurate. And of course, it's easy for us to cheat them. We just go like that for 5-10 minutes, and I've done another 2,000 steps. You're going to be conned both ways. And then, of course, we've seen this with an IoT device, essentially a sensor, which failed without being detected as having failed. That was a tragedy. So the questions go back to your data. You've got your business model, you know what you want to do with it, you know how you're going to get value. What are the fundamental questions you need to ask about that use case, the source of the data, the accuracy equipment, the sensors, and the accuracy and effectiveness of those algorithms? I leave you with those questions, ladies and gentlemen. You can get good value if you ask yourselves the right questions. very much.
We have a couple of minutes for questions here. This was interesting. I think I like the one thing that you were asking the right question, focusing on business value and stuff like that. I was curious about how you see proof of concepts, the work around proof of concepts, because you're sitting there, you have an idea about a tracker and everything looks great on paper, but the way of finding out that there's a missing accuracy is proof of concepts, in my world at least. Yeah. I like proof of concepts. What's your thoughts about
I mean, absolutely vital. That's why I got my students to go about 3-4 years ago with their smartphones. Some of them had 2 different models of smartphones. To go to plan locations, Google Maps, find that XY latitude, longitude, take a photo, look at the tag, see what it says. And we picked up back then the biggest data set that we could see anywhere of 2,600 odd photos, location tagged. And it proved that, yes, GPS in a good environment, it had a circular error probability plus or minus 5 meters, it's now claimed, 95% of the readings in an open environment will be within 5 meters. What we discovered was the effect of the CDP was plus or minus 25 meters, 85% of the time. And the remaining photos were tagged anything up to 1,800 kilometers out of place. 25 meters doesn't matter. But if you're doing location-based advertising, you've got reputation issues possibly, because if I get a 40-mile away one, I'm going to be a bit upset and start thinking I'm being spammed. And a company in the States that has been doing some surveys, or did them a few years ago, 15% of all location-tagged adverts were going 100 kilometers away from where the person really was, or were measured, being measured as 100 kilometers away.
But this also goes to other use cases and locations, I guess.
Yeah, it depends what you want to do, but the same goes with almost everything else. It's like kind of what Capuchato was saying. You know, you've actually got to test it out. You've got to do you move through from the right idea to starting to making it and see, does it actually work? And with calorie counting, because 2 people, the same weight or same height, don't have the same metabolism. They change their metabolism from day to day. And we all have different mechanical efficiency with our arms and legs and bone lengths and so on and so forth. So there's no way that any Fitbit can count your calories within 20, 30, 50%. And yet, so people are getting fatter. Because they trust it, and when they've done 2,000 calories, apparently 2,000 calories more than their target, they reward themselves with a burger or something nice, and they're actually getting fatter.
Good. And time for our last question from the audience. For you.
Do you know why they didn't put up the right question in the right time?
Sorry, say again. I think one of the problems is that we aren't trained early enough in our lives to ask questions. Well, it's actually not like that. Our education system currently is incredibly effective at turning those astonishingly inquisitive creatures called 2- and 3-year-olds, why, learning how to pass the test. And when I get them at university, our students have lost the ability to be inquisitive or curious. It takes a lot of effort to put that back into them.
We need to stop here. I think you'll be around?
Yes, I'm around until about 2 o'clock.
So we'll group into 2 groups now. The orange people, they will stay in here. And the other colors, they will go out to networking sessions. So please, if you're not orange, time to go to a network. And welcome if you are orange, if you are new one in the room. We'll now go over and